I'm Henry Galan. I am professor of obstetrics and gynecology and maternal-fetal medicine at the University of Colorado School of Medicine. I have a long-standing interest in intrauterine growth restriction, both from a clinical and research standpoint. IUGR is a term that's used interchangeably with fetal growth restriction and small for gestational age to describe a fetus that measures small for its gestational age in pregnancy. IUGR is most commonly defined as an estimated fetal weight less than the 10th percentile. This graph shows estimated fetal weight across gestation with weeks on the x-axis and the estimated fetal weight in grams on the left axis. The bottom white line represents the 10th percentile across gestational age. And if a fetus is noted to be below that white line at any point across gestation, it is referred to as IUGR. IUGR is important to identify in pregnancy because it carries risks to both the mother and the fetus. Maternal risks include increased testing, which results in lost time from work and other activities, and delivery by cesarean section for fetal heart rate abnormalities. The fetus is at risk for low blood oxygen levels and low blood pH, fetal heart rate abnormalities before and during labor, and stillbirth. Newborn risks include low Apgar scores and low blood pH, and a variety of complications that include meconium aspiration syndrome, respiratory distress syndrome, a variety of metabolic disorders including low blood sugars, and long-term neurodevelopmental delay and cerebral palsy risks. It also places the adult that fetus is destined to become at risk for diabetes, coronary vascular disease, and stroke later in life. Understanding the cause of an IUGR fetus is important as it dictates the outcome and continued surveillance of the pregnancy. The causes of IUGR can generally be divided into maternal, placental, or fetal. Maternal causes include poor dating of the pregnancy, chronic medical conditions, malnutrition, toxins, certain prescribed medications. Placental factors include abnormal placental size, placental abruption, which is early separation of the placenta with bleeding, placental infarction, which refers to cessation of blood flow to an area of the placenta, chorioangioma, which is a tumor of the placenta, and abnormal umbilical cord insertions, such as membranous cord insertions. Fetal factors include structural abnormalities, congenital infection, multiple gestations, such as twins and triplets, and genetic factors that include chromosomal abnormalities or a variety of syndromes. However, genetic factors can also be normal, something we refer to as constitutional smallness, where the parents are simply of short stature. We have various tests or tools that can help us define the cause, but we don't always find out what the reason a baby is small for prior to birth. These approaches include a detailed ultrasound of the fetal anatomy to ensure there are no obvious structural abnormalities in the fetus, Doppler velocimetry, which is another type of ultrasound tool to look at blood flow patterns to test the resistance of blood flow through the placenta. A maternal blood draw may also be recommended that can give us an indication if there's a genetic or infectious cause for the growth restriction. An amniocentesis may also be recommended, which is where a small sample of amniotic fluid is drawn from the amniotic sac surrounding the fetus. Fortunately, serious causes of IUGR that can lead to death or severe handicap are relatively uncommon. When a patient first receives the news that their fetus has IUGR, they are, of course, concerned and anxious. So it's important when reviewing the diagnosis and various causes of IUGR with patients to let them know that the majority of fetuses less than the 10th percentile are normal. I usually explain further that one can be tighter with the definition, for example, using an estimated fetal weight less than the 3rd percentile, but then you may be missing IUGR fetuses that are at the 8th percentile who may be at risk. Once the diagnosis of IUGR is made, treatment is dependent on the underlying cause. Unfortunately, there is little that can be done for many of the causes. If the cause is a genetic abnormality, there's nothing that can be done because we cannot change the genetics of a fetus. But understanding the genetic abnormality is important as it can determine whether there's risk of recurrence in the next pregnancy. There's also little to no treatment available for infectious causes of IUGR. What can be done is optimizing the health of the pregnancy in general, including maintaining good maternal hydration and nutrition, and controlling chronic medical conditions, for example, controlling blood pressures and chronic hypertension, specifically trying to keep them out of the severe range, and controlling blood sugars and diabetes. We have a variety of tools to assess a fetus to ensure well-being or to determine whether a fetus is developing further problems that could lead to injury or death of the fetus. These tools include serial ultrasounds for growth every 3 to 4 weeks. These graphs show serial growth for two different fetuses. The graph on the left shows a small fetus that is staying on its own growth curve throughout gestation, whereas the second graph showing the growth of a different fetus shows the fetus initially staying on its own growth curve and then falling off of the growth curve. Another tool that we use is Doppler ultrasound for blood flow assessment in the umbilical artery that really reflects the resistance to blood flow within the placenta. We also perform Doppler velocimetry in the middle cerebral artery in the brain of the fetus to see if there's any presence of low blood oxygen levels or hypoxemia. Another tool that we use is antepartum testing. There's a couple of them available, including a non-stress test where we simply put fetal heart rate monitoring belts on the mom's belly to look at the fetal heart rate tracing and look for specific characteristics of the tracing that provide reassurance. And biophysical profile, which is an ultrasound test looking at fetal movement, fetal breathing motions, fetal tone, and amniotic fluid volume. There are a variety of factors that dictate or influence the decision to deliver a small fetus. Our goal is always to gain gestational age to allow the fetus to mature, become bigger, and to avoid prematurity complications. If all testing is normal and growth is maintained, the delivery can occur at 39 weeks, very close to the patient's due date. If Doppler ultrasound shows mild abnormalities, delivery may be recommended at 37 weeks. If there are severe abnormalities present, hospitalization may be recommended with delivery by 32 or 34 weeks, depending on the abnormality. Antepartum testing abnormalities can also dictate that delivery occur more quickly. The recurrence risk for IUGR in a subsequent pregnancy is dependent on the underlying cause for IUGR in the first pregnancy. In the absence of a genetic or infectious cause of IUGR, the recurrence risk for IUGR in the next pregnancy is estimated to be between 20 and 25%. There are a few things that can be done to understand and potentially reduce the risk of recurrence of IUGR in a subsequent pregnancy. A preconception visit with your obstetrician or maternal fetal medicine specialist is recommended as they can review prior pregnancy, perhaps the pathologic exam of the placenta, if there was a genetic cause and what the recurrence risk would be, review maternal medications and to optimize maternal health prior to the pregnancy. Further, there's evidence that a baby aspirin a day or an 81 milligram tablet of aspirin can help reduce the risk of recurrent IUGR.